In this video, we are going to continue to look at the evolution of different forms of life out there and continue on where we're going to look at this process of eukaryotic life moving on to the land. And we saw how the fungi that were out there were able to colonize land. And during this process, they were also colonizing land along with our plants that are out there. And remember, when we're looking in the plant kingdom, this is characterized by multicellular eukaryotic organisms that are photoautotrophs. So they get their energy from light and they can automatically get access to their carbon source that is out there. So let's take a look at this process and think about what's going on, because remember, when we're considering this idea of evolution, we're looking at the algae ancestors that are out there that had to move onto land into what's really a change from an aquatic environment to a terrestrial environment. And if you think about this process, the algae that are out there in the water are able to do photosynthesis pretty much anywhere within the body of the algae there, because they had photosynthetic tissues that were there. They could also absorb water for photosynthesis. They could absorb carbon dioxide and minerals from the water basically anywhere over their surface. So this is really a multi-purpose kind of organism when you're looking at the multicellular algae that are out there. The water was providing support for their bodies to allow them to kind of stand up. And then the other thing, when you look at the process of reproduction for algae, their gametes actually had flagella in order to swim through the ocean and through the water so that you could have fertilization occurring. Now think about that process if you're a plant. You would need to be able to remodel the structures within the algae to allow the algae to survive on land. And so what are you going to need? What's the advantage to this? Well, think about it. This plant is going to have more access to light and carbon dioxide, because you're not going to have to depend on the light or the gas being able to pass through the water there. So you're going to have that as a definite benefit for the plants that are out there. But at the same time, the support that was provided by the water for the algae is gone, and you're going to run into a slight problem with water. So you're going to have to come up with some adaptations that would allow these algae to be able to survive on land. So keep that in mind as we look through this process of the evolution of plants that are out there. And if we take a look at the evidence that is available out there in fossil records and also in the kinds of organisms that we can find these days, what we do see is that there are four major adaptations that these algae made when they moved onto land and became the plant kingdom. And one of them is what's known as the alternation of generations. And this is kind of an interesting thing where the algae can basically go through two different stages in their life cycle. During one stage, the cells are haploid cells, so they have one copy of all their chromosomes. Remember, eukaryotic cells with a nucleus, and those cells could divide by mitosis and make what's known as the gametophyte generation. And so this would be an algae that you could see out there growing. And if you think about it, any cell on that algae could be a gamete cell because they're all haploid. So those cells just need to divide by mitosis, and then those cells could not so much break off so much as divide separately from the adult organism. And then those gametes that were produced would have the flagella that could swim around, and they could fuse into other gametes with flagella. And now you've got your diploid zygote that can divide by mitosis and grow up. And the amazing thing is, when you look at what's referred to as the sporophyte generation, it could look exactly the same as the gametophyte, but if you went into the nucleus, you would find that these cells were actually diploid. So this looks the same until you get down to the genetic level and you start looking at the chromosomes. These guys, because they are diploid cells, could divide by mitosis to grow up and make the adult sporophyte, and then those cells could undergo meiosis, and that would produce your haploid spores that could swim around, and again, they could land somewhere in the mud and then start dividing by mitosis to give you that gametophyte. So an interesting way of looking at this, and they literally do alternate their generations between a diploid and a haploid generation, going back and forth between these two types of growth. Well, that's one thing. The other thing to consider is when you're going onto land, remember that you're going to be in a dry environment. And so you have to find some way to protect these cells that are being produced. And so what the algae did is they remodeled their existing structures, and that's what we see in plants. One of those is what's referred to as a sporangium, which are these little green things that you can see here. And if you look outside after all the rains, you might actually see this on some of the short little plants that are out there. And here you're producing a sac that is known as a sporangium that's going to protect your haploid spores that are being produced. Down here in the bottom, we can see another version of this, and this is what's known as a gametangium, and it's kind of a similar thing in terms of the sporangium, but here you're looking at a chamber that's being produced where the gametes can actually be produced via the process of mitosis. So very similar to what we saw with our algae that are out there, but now you are starting to make a specialized structure where you can protect those cells. And we'll see as we look at this that you can actually see differences in terms of male and female versions of these, where you can produce your egg cells and your sperm cells in specific locations on the plant and protect them. Remember, at this point, we're still tied to our algae that had these cells that were produced with the little flagella to allow them to swim. And that's not going to work in your terrestrial environment because you don't have all that liquid available floating around. The last thing that we can see when we look at our algae that had to adapt to land is a variety of different kinds of structural adaptations that took place. So think about your algae that are out there. They're floating around in the water that's providing them support. Well, now when we look at our plants that are out there, we see this development of the shoot that is going to provide support for the rest of the plant with leaves on it. And the leaves are basically a broad version of that where you can have more and more photosynthesis occurring. They still are able to do photosynthesis within the shoots right here. The other thing is, think about if this is going to be outside, this is going to really suffer from or be exposed to the elements, and that could allow it to dry out. So when you look at this, you have to form some sort of skin, and the algae's solution as they adapted to land and became plants is to form a waxy surface layer, which we can feel in some plants out there, and this is known as cuticle. And this would be the equivalent to the animal adaptation of forming skin, again, to protect those organisms from drying out as they moved from the ocean onto land. And the last thing that we see down here is roots. And if you look at an algae out there, they have a very primitive version of a root down at the bottom here that's known as a holdfast. And the root structure really evolved to anchor that plant, but also they started remodeling that, and your roots are going to be able to absorb water and minerals from the soil. And it's really important to remember that as the fungi evolved with these plants, that's where we see those mycorrhizae. If you remember from the previous chapter, mycorrhizae are fungi that actually grow into the root structure, and they basically increase the availability of minerals and water. So they're adding on to the root structure. So they co-evolve. The plant is giving the fungus sugars, and the fungus is increasing the transport of nutrients and water that the plant's going to need. So both organisms benefit from that symbiotic relationship. One of the other kind of interesting kinds of structural features that we do see when we look at the plants that are out there is different kinds of tissues start to form, and you need to be a multicellular organism, and this is a distinct difference when we compare the algae with the plants that are out there, is the formation of tissues. And one type of tissue we can see over here is what's known as a vascular tissue, and this is similar to a vascular tissue that we find in animals that are out there, where we're using arteries and veins to transport fluids throughout our bodies. But for a plant, they're going to form these vascular tissues to allow them to transport really important kind of materials throughout the organism there. And we find two types of vascular tissue. They're known as xylem and phloem. And you can see from the arrows, really the general direction for how transport is going on. When you look at the phloem that is out there, and this could be in leaves, it's definitely going to be in the shoot, and it works its way down into the roots. This is going to basically be taking sugars that are produced in the photosynthetic part of the organism and transporting those down from the leaves to the roots and other non-photosynthetic parts of the plant. The xylem, on the other hand, is going to be working in the opposite direction. So this is going to be transporting those water and minerals from the roots up to the leaves. And so you can sort of remember, you xylem up, phloem down. And if you remember that mnemonic, you just need to think, okay, what's flowing down? The sugars are going down, and the xylem is the water in the soil that's being transported up. The other important kind of tissue that we start to see developing in our plants out there is something that's known as the apical meristem. And the apex would be like the top of something. And so this is really a cap of cells that is going to be along the top of the plant, but also there's another cap of cells that's in the root tip. And what these are going to do is they are cells that are going to continue to proliferate. So these are cells that are going to divide by mitosis, and that's going to allow the plant to basically extend from the ends of the tips. So one meristem is going to be up here, and it's going to allow the plant to grow up. And then the other meristem is down here in the root tip, and that's going to allow your plant to continue to grow down and extend those roots out. This is really important when we look at plants being able to access not only sunlight as they work their way up, but also in order to get their roots through the soil so they can get access to things like water and minerals that are available out there. There is something, because if you think about it, this would just result in really skinny plants because they're just going to grow up and down. There is another meristem. It's known as the lateral meristem. And again, these are going to be cells that allow the tissues to grow outward. So that's going to increase the diameter of your stem or your tree trunk that is out there. So we've got apical meristem to allow them to grow up and lateral meristem to allow them to grow to the sides there. And if we look at this overall process, there is evidence within the fossil record that plants went through four major periods of evolution as they moved onto land. And again, there is this process that as you move from one habitat to another, your organisms are going to go through the process of natural selection. And in this case, nature selected for the algae that had the mutations that allowed those particular members of the population to successfully move to a new neighborhood. And so what we're going to see is your algae are going to be modified into what are known as the bryophytes. And then you're going to start to get development of those vascular tissues with the xylem and phloem. And that's going to allow these plants to start getting a little bit taller because they can transport materials. And then we see the production of our seed plants that are out there. And these guys are going to allow those modified algae to really spread across the surface of the planet onto that terrestrial environment.